We are diving back into John chapter 9 and chapter 10 this morning. And chapter 9 is a continuation of chapter 8, where they're still in Jerusalem. Jesus goes in, he heals a blind man that had been blind from birth. And then towards the end of chapter 9, he goes and seeks out this man like a shepherd seeking out his sheep. And then in chapter 10, we learn where he says, "I am the good shepherd." And so if you have your Bible, we're going to open up to John chapter 9 and 10. We'll be studying that. We're going to do like we did last week. We're going to kind of fly in. We're going to dip down to some important parts. Not that it's not all important, but some highlighted parts. And then we'll dip back out and dip back in. And so we're going to follow kind of the same format that we did last week. But as we begin that, would you pray with me? Father, I am inadequate to stand on this stage to open your word and to divide it. But you are not. And so, God, I pray that you would, Lord, just allow me to shrink back any pride, any ego, any knowledge or wisdom that I think I may have, so that you can speak through me. These people in this room, to include myself, do not need to hear from me today. They need to hear from you. So, God, I pray that you would speak loud and speak clear. We love you and say these things in the precious name of Christ. Amen. Chapter 9, verse 1, as Jesus was walking along, he saw a man who had been blind from birth. Rabbi, or teacher, your Bible may say, master, some translations, his disciples asked him, why was this man blind? Was it because of his own sin or his parents' sin? Here's a man who's laying along the side, he's begging for alms. There's not much in biblical times that I would imagine that a blind person could do. I'm only assuming they haven't invented Braille yet, that he's not able to do that, that they haven't come up with the American Disabilities Act where he could, you know, learn to do different things and people would have to bring him in and training as part of the thing. So what a lot they could do, same thing with maybe a lame man who couldn't walk, they would just sit along and they would beg for money. And as Jesus approaches this man, the disciples, not the everyday people pressing him, but the disciples, said, who sinned? This man's parents or him? Kind of an odd question, right? I mean, do you ever see anybody when you go to the hospital and you're thinking to yourself, I wonder who sinned? Them or their parents? I mean, I don't ever ask that question. But it's one of those questions that the disciples were asking, and we might be able to understand the parental question, right? Did his parents sin and therefore God is punishing them? Listen, we live in a world today where the world is waiting on God to drop the hammer because of what they do wrong. We live in a world today where sometimes the church is waiting on the hammer to drop because of what they do wrong. Can I tell you this? God does not operate that way. You don't operate that way with your children. I don't operate that way with my children. God doesn't operate that way with his children. Will he discipline us? You need to hear me clearly on this. Absolutely. But he is not waiting to drop the hammer every time you or I mess up. He's not going to inflict us with something just because we went the other way and decided to do something our way instead of his way. And so the disciples are asking this question, but then they ask a very different part. And they said, or was it the kid? As if the kid that wasn't born had sinned already. And so there we find in the culture of this time, we find in this Jewish culture, especially in Old Testament time, that there was this thing considered prenatal sin. It's where maybe the child in the womb has sinned. They get this from Jacob and Esau. If you remember, Jacob and Esau were fighting in the womb. I mean, when you read scripture of that, there's no doubt that the two of them were going at it. And so they had this idea that there's this prenatal sin. I don't see that anywhere in scripture. My biggest struggle sometimes with Tulip and the whole Calvinism thing is that we are born sinners. I struggle with that because I look at a little bitty baby who hasn't sinned and think, man, what did my grandson do at hour minute one that was a sin? Now I know because of my reading and my studying and the conviction of the Holy Spirit that we are all born sinners. You don't have to teach a baby to say that's mine and you can't have it. They figure that out. You don't have to teach a child how to say no when they shouldn't say no. Matter of fact, I've been teaching my grandson, Bo. He was in the car. He's starting to put multiple words together. He loves going through names. He goes through, yesterday he was saying Tandy for Tanya, Becky. He went through everybody's name. And then he was saying something, and he wanted out of the car seat. My daughter said something to him, and I said, "Bo, you just say no, no, mama." And he started going, "No, no, mama," over and over. And my daughter's going, "Bo, you don't say that to your mama." And I said, "Bo, you can come to Papa's house." I love being a grandparent. That's not the economy that God operates in. He goes on to say, Jesus speaking, he says, "It was not because of his sins or his parents' sins," Jesus answered. "This happened so the power of God could be seen in him." People get confused here, especially depending what translation you use. Because there's a word that in verse 2 that we also see in verse 3. And one ends up being a result of, and the other one ends up being a purpose of. And here's what you need to understand, that when Jesus is talking to the disciples and he says, it was not because of his sins that he's laying there blind, his sins or his parents' sins, but as this happened so that the power of God could be seen in him. God did not purpose in this man when he was a child to be born blind so that God could later say, "Watch this, I can make him see." What God did is he took a situation because of sin in this world that this child happened to be born blind. And God said, "I will use it for my purpose to bring glory." Do you understand what I'm saying? Amen. Just because you have cancer doesn't mean that God gave you cancer so that you could later ring the bell and he could say, "I freed you of your cancer." See, we ask the wrong question. We ask the question of why. Why do I have cancer? Why does this person die? Why do I have to have stitches? Why is my son or my child born this way? Why do they have Down syndrome? Why do I have a thyroid disease? Why do I whatever? When we should be asking the question of how? How is God going to use this to bring himself glory? See, we ask the wrong question. Because when we ask the question why, it puts it on us. As if for somehow we're too good to have cancer. Like, "God, I am too good. I am too above cancer." That's not the case. The question is, how? God, how are you going to use this cancer to bring yourself glory? I've asked the questions before. I've asked the questions of God, why? Why does my daughter have a brain tumor? And then the other week, I went to lunch with Ansel Overby from the Crisis Pregnancy Center. And we were talking about my daughter. He said, "Chris, would your daughter be willing to speak at the Crisis Pregnancy Banquet?" Talking about how the doctors thought that, you know, maybe the best thing is her not fight for the baby's life when he was born. I said, "I think she might." And so she is. It's not why. It's how is God going to use it to bring himself glory? Jesus goes on. He says, "We must quickly carry out the task assigned to us by the one who sent us. The night is coming, and then no one can work. But while I'm here in the world, I am the light of the world." What is Jesus saying? He's saying, look, your time and my time, it's drawing quickly to an end. And there is work to be done. Remember what we said about the harvest, but yet there are few to do the harvesting? We have work to do, church. And sooner or later, our time is going to run out. That clock is going tick, tock, tick, tock, tick, tock. And you can't stop it. You can't stop it. I can't stop it. And here Jesus is saying, we got to get the work done. It's got to go quickly because the one who sent us, the night is coming and that no one can work. He said, but while I am here in the world, I am the light of the world. Listen, Jesus was the light when he was here. He said that earlier in John. He said, I am the light. But Matthew 5:13 says that we are to be light and salt. Listen, you and I can't be Jesus. I wish I could. No, I don't. I don't want that kind of pressure. We can't be Jesus, but we can be a reflection of the light. And so we can be a light in this world. And so if you go out of here today and you don't take the opportunity to be a light wherever you're at, if you don't take an opportunity to be the light at work tomorrow, you're missing it. You're missing it. Yesterday, my wife and I went to Captain Steve's to get something to eat. The young lady came over there to take care of us. Something come up and I said, I don't know, you wouldn't do a preacher like that, would you? She's like, you're a preacher? I said, that's the same response I get from everybody. She said, well, where do you pastor at? I said, well, it's in Gastonia. She said, I love church. I might come visit you. I said, well, where do you live? She's like, I'm going to school in Rock Hill. And so I live in Rock Hill. I said, can I tell you what? First Baptist has a great program. They got a collegiate program. They got kids there in Winthrop. I said, I think you'll fit right. It's not because I didn't want her to come here. It's just because I knew that was in her area. And the likelihood of her going there was a lot greater. What was I doing? I was trying to be a reflection of the light. Saying, hey, listen, don't miss out just because I'm in Gastonia and you live in Rock Hill. Go be a part of it. Her next thing was, do you have a business card? Diana looks at me like, well, I was like, I just had 2,000 of them printed, but I don't have one on me. And Diana's like, why not? I said, where am I going to carry it? I'm not going to be one of those guys that goes, here's my card. This is not who I am. So I pulled up my card on my phone and said, here, you want to take a picture of it? So she took a picture of it. She said, I'm going to convince you. She said, I just got to get off work. She said, I work here all the time. I said, you walk around with your phone out. You'll have plenty of time tomorrow. Because she got fired. Church, we don't have all day to get it done. So we got to get it done. Goes on to say, Jesus spit on the ground and he took dust and dirt and he spit on it and made mud and he wiped it in the guy's eyes. Now here's a guy that hasn't been able to see since birth. And he wiped it in the guy's eyes and he's sitting down and he said, here's what I want you to do. I'm going to wipe this in your eyes and I want you to go down to the pool called Siloam. And he said, and then I want you to rinse your eyes off. But that pool means scent or sin. He said, I want you to go down to that pool and I want you to rinse your eyes off. And so the man, he takes that mud, he goes down to the pool. Somebody, I'm assuming, helped him get there. He gets in there and rinses his eyes off. And next thing you know, he is washed and came back seeing. His neighbors and others who knew him as a blind beggar asked each other, isn't this the man who used to sit and beg? Some said he was, and others said, no, he just looks like him. But the beggar kept saying, yes, I am the same one. They asked, who healed you? What happened? He told them, the man they called Jesus made mud and spread it over my eyes and told me, go to the pool of Siloam and wash yourself. So I went and washed, and now I can see. Where is he now, they asked. He said, I don't know. He said, then they took the blind man over to the Pharisees, and they presented him to the Pharisees. They're like, look, here's this guy that said he couldn't see. We know him as being a blind guy that's been sitting over here just begging for money. And now all of a sudden he can see him. We don't know what's going on. He can't tell us who did it other than the fact that it was Jesus. But we don't see that guy anywhere else. So we need you to press in and find out what's going on. Then the Pharisees again questioned the man who had been blind and demanded, what's your opinion about this man who healed you? The man replied, I think he must be a prophet. The Jewish leaders still refused to believe the blind man could see now. And so they went third grade on him. They called his parents. They're like, hey, are you the parents of this guy that was blind sitting over there? Like, he says he can see now. Was he really blind? The parents start having the conversation. They say, yeah, that's our son. And yes, he was really blind. And yes, now he can see. Well, how is this possible? The parents refused to answer the question. They didn't want to answer the question that there was this man named Jesus because the Pharisees are already building up this case against Jesus. And they knew if they'd answered the question that Jesus healed their son, they'd have been outcast from the synagogue. They'd have been kicked out of the temple. They'd have been excommunicated from the faith. So they refused to answer the question. So for the second time, they called in the man who had been blind and told him, God should get the glory for this because we know this man, Jesus, is a sinner. The Pharisees are pressing in on this guy again. And they're saying, you keep saying Jesus healed you, but God should get the glory for this because Jesus is just a sinning man just like everybody else. See, the Pharisees still hadn't gotten the fact of who Jesus really was. In verse 25 of chapter 9, he says, I don't know whether he is a sinner, the man replied, but I know this. I was blind, and now I can see. What more do you need? The Pharisees, the world's pressing in on him. He says, I ain't got a clue. I just know I couldn't see before, and now I can. This man's building up a strong case for the second greatest story ever told. I told you earlier in the book of John that Jesus gave the seven replies to the woman, seven replies. It was a master class on meeting someone in commonality and leading them to the gospel. Here we see the second greatest story ever told, which is mine and your story. See, here's the truth. You can argue all day with me about Scripture. I can say, hey, the Red Sea parted and the Israelites walked across. And you can say, there are certain times and certain seasons at a certain moon phase that the Red Sea is only 2 inches deep. And you can walk across it yourself, Chris. And I go, okay, yeah, you're right. I can tell you that God created the heavens and the earth. He took the mountains and he pushed them up. And he created this beauty. And you can say, well, yeah, Chris, but you know what? There's these shifts underneath the ground, these plates, and as they push together, it causes the crust of the earth to rise up. And I'd say, yeah, okay, you're right. But then I can tell you there was this 16, 17, 18-year-old kid that had a potty mouth like none other, that was lost, going to hell, that knew nothing about Jesus, didn't want to know nothing about Jesus, that was a Mormon, wanted nothing to do with that either. Yet God got a hold of his heart and radically changed him, that he never cussed again. That he's living for Christ day after day the best he can. And that kid is me. And you can say whatever you want to, but you can't argue it. Because that's my story. This man said, I don't know. I was blind, but now I can see. He got a little sarcastic with the Pharisees because they were pushing in. Right after he said that, they said, but what did he do? How did he heal you? The man said, look, what, you want to be a disciple too? He got a little sarcastic. He's like, do you want to believe too? Do you want him to come talk to you? The Pharisees went on and cursed him and said, you are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know God spoke to Moses, but we don't even know where this man comes from. The man replied, he healed my eyes, and yet you do not know where he comes from. And then it says that just a little short time and a few sentences later, that they threw him out of the synagogue. He was no longer allowed to be a good Jewish man because he believed that this Jesus guy had healed him. When Jesus heard what happened, he found the man, the shepherd, who went to look for the sheep. When Jesus heard what happened, he found the man and he says, do you believe in the Son of Man? The man answered, who is he, sir? I want to believe in him. You have seen him, Jesus said, and he is speaking to you. Yes, Lord, I believe, the man said, and he worshiped Jesus. Then Jesus told him, I entered this world to render judgment, to give sight to the blind and to show those who think they see that they are blind. Some Pharisees who were standing nearby heard him and asked, are you saying we're blind? If you were blind, you wouldn't be guilty, Jesus replied. But you remain guilty because you claim you can see. Jesus said, I came to give sight to the blind. And the Pharisees press in and say, well, are you saying we're blind? And what Jesus is saying here is saying, no, you're not blind. Because if you were blind, then I could help you see. But the fact that you think you can see makes you blind. That's the judgment on me. You see, we live in a world and a culture today where everybody thinks there's another way. Where everybody thinks their way is right. Where everybody thinks you just have to be a good person to get to heaven. And Jesus is saying, because you believe that, you're blind to what I'm here for. So because you can see, but you're seeing wrong, that's going to be your judgment. How does that happen? I think the heart just gets hardened to the things of God. Walt Abercrombie and I were having a discussion about this morning. We were talking about the fact that some people need to come to some real reality adjustments. And I said, well, here's the problem is they can't come to reality until they're willing to accept the truth. And Walt said, is that not the same thing? I said, matter of fact, it is. You want to preach one? He sharply declined. Although he did tell me, Miss Joy, he had to preach it in a church. I want to see the tape. Jesus goes on in chapter 10, he says, I tell you the truth, anyone who sneaks over the wall of the sheepfold rather than going through the gate must surely be a thief and a robber. But the one who enters through the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep recognize his voice and come to him. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. After he has gathered his own flock, he walks ahead of them, and they follow him because they know his voice. They won't follow a stranger. They will run from him, because they do not know his voice. There's a very unique thing going on here. Whenever you would look at the way the shepherds would do the sheep in biblical days, they would find a steep cliff, they would find maybe a mountainside wall, and they would build a 3-foot-high fence from either that cliff around it or from that wall out. They would build this 3-foot-high fence, and then they would layer it up with thorns and thicket and stuff like that so that the wolves couldn't get in. And they would leave a little small gate so that they could bring the sheep in through that gate and take the sheep out through that gate. And they would either make a gate, or at times they would actually have a human. The shepherd would lay down where the gate's supposed to be so that the sheep couldn't get out, but yet he could still be alert if the wolf was trying to get in. It wasn't uncommon for several shepherds to get together and put their sheep all in the same pen. And here's the thing you have to know is when we think about sheep and shepherds these days, we think about sheepdog, that they run around and kind of herd up the sheep and they would bring them into the pen or they bring them into the fence. I know you've seen the sheepdog just like I have. They didn't have sheepdog back then in Israel. They just used the shepherd. The shepherd would call his sheep and the sheep would begin to follow him. The shepherd would say, get out, and the sheep would get out. And it didn't matter if there were several herds of sheep, there were several shepherds, because the sheep knew the voice of their shepherd. And Jesus is saying, my sheep know my voice because I know my sheep. Very important part here. He goes on and explains to him. He says, I tell you the truth, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me were thieves and robbers, but the true sheep did not listen to them. Yes, I am the gate. Remember what Jesus says? No one comes to the Father except through the Son. He said, those who come in through me will be saved. They will come and go freely and will find pastures. The thief's purpose is to steal and kill and destroy. My purpose is to give them a rich and satisfying life. Here we need to understand that when Jesus says, I am here to give you a rich and satisfying life, he never promised the American Christian lots of money in the bank account, an exotic car, a multi-bedroom house, and a perfect life. Jesus said, I came to give you a rich and fulfilling life. Yesterday when I was preaching Miss Faye's funeral, I talked about the fruit of the Spirit: love, peace, joy, kindness, gentleness, self-control. There were two words in the fruit of the Spirit that stood out to me with this faith: joy and kindness. But that first one, joy. Joy is being content in all situations. That's the richness that Jesus promised us. Listen, I don't know where in America we came up with this idea of retiring at 62. 65 for some of your generations. Unfortunately, for this generation, it looks like it's going to be about 92. I don't read anywhere in Scripture where it says, and then Moses retired. And then Abraham retired. I don't read that anywhere in there. They just worked and worked and worked and worked, and they did, and they made life of it. They had joy. And Jesus says, I come give you a rich and satisfying life. And then he says in verse 11, if you want to underline it, one of the seven I am's, he says, I am the good shepherd. And he says, the good shepherd sacrifices his life for the sheep. And we know that we are only within days, if that, of Jesus doing that for his sheep. He goes on to verse 14, he says, I am the good shepherd. I know my own sheep, and they know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. So I sacrifice my life for the sheep, and the other sheep too that are not in the sheepfold. I must bring them in also. They will listen to my voice, and they will be one flock with one shepherd. And then Jesus goes on down in verse 22. Here it's now winter time. It's getting close to that season. A couple months has passed. And it says in here that it was now winter and Jesus was in Jerusalem for the time of the festival of dedication. And so we got to ask ourselves, well, what is this festival of dedication? Jesus would have been at the temple. He would have been sitting at the portico of Solomon. And in that portico, there were 30-foot-high columns. This was a massive area that in the wintertime, in the cold time, people would have congregated. There have been people outside teaching. And so they're in this area with 30-foot high columns, so 30-foot ceilings. They got a 60-foot deep from side to side, from the side of the temple out to the wall. Then from the wall all the way down would have been 1,500 feet. This was a massive area where they're sitting, and they're sitting out in this portico. And as they're sitting in Solomon's colonnade, Jesus is sitting there, and they're celebrating the festival of dedication. And if you're not familiar with the festival of dedication is, then you need to understand this, that there was a time when Alexander the Great and his descendants, they kind of broke up their empire, the Alexander the Great's empire. When they broke it up, they kind of gave away a few pieces, and the Syrians had one piece of that. And the piece that the Syrians had would have been controlling most of God's people. And so during this time, they had a guy that was the leader of the Syrians, and he wanted to do away with any type of Jewish religion. He had determined that he was going to just get rid of it. And so he comes into the temple. He executes the priest, the high priest. And when he executes the high priest, he takes a pig and he sacrifices the pig. But then he takes the blood of the pig and starts putting it all over the temple elements. He put it all over the menorah. He put it all over the Old Testament word that they would have had, that they would have preached from all the time. And he put this pig blood over everything, trying to defile it all. There were some priests that went into hiding. The high priest that was killed, some of the other priests went into hiding, and he almost succeeded in getting rid of the religion. But then the Maccabee brothers rose up. Some of you may understand that name Maccabee. It's a book that's found in the Apocrypha that the Catholics read, but we really don't recognize that as the canon of Scripture. But these Maccabee brothers were real people, and so they rose up. And it took them about 3 years. In 165 B.C., they run the Syrians out of there and restored the temple. They found a copy of the Torah that hadn't been defiled in the blood. They brought it out and they cleaned it up. And they found some priests that were in hiding and brought them back. And they revived the Jewish religion. And so when they did that, they celebrate that feast of dedication, that cleansing, if you will, every year in December. And if you want to read more about it, it's now called Hanukkah. So Hanukkah is that feast of dedication. And so it was this time period that we're in. And as we're there, Jesus is in the middle of talking. The people are surrounding him and ask, how long are you going to keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly. And Jesus replied, I have already told you and you don't believe me. The proof is in the work I do in my Father's name. But you don't believe me because you are not my sheep. My sheep listen to my voice and I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they will never perish. And listen to what he says. No one can snatch them away from me. For my Father has given them to me. Jesus is saying, no one can snatch them from my hand. Sounds great, but then he's getting ready to, is he contradicting himself in just a minute? He says, and he is more powerful than anyone else. No one can snatch them from the Father's hand. So are we in Jesus' hand or are we in the Father's hand? That would be a great question. So Jesus answers that. He says, the Father and I are one. Nowhere in the Scripture does it say anything about the sheep that choose to wander out the gate, that choose to go outside of the will of God, that choose to go outside of doing what the shepherd wants them to do. But it does say for you and I that if we are the sheep of the shepherd and we're in his will and doing what he wants us to do and we're enjoying his fellowship, that in that nobody can ever snatch us out of his hand. We find ourselves sometimes in this battle with powers that are dark because Jesus is the light, but there's also shade. And when we're living outside of the will of God, then guess what? We're living outside of the hand of God. So when we find ourselves in this chaos, in this turmoil, then we need to ask ourselves, did I wander outside the gate? Chances are we'll find ourselves there. He goes on to say, they replied, We're stoning you not for any good work, but for the blasphemy you mere man claim to be. Jesus replied, it is written in your own scriptures that God said to certain leaders of the people, I say you are gods. And you know that the scriptures cannot be altered. So if those people who received God's message were called gods, why do you call it blasphemy when I say that I am the Son of God? Here Jesus is making an Old Testament reference. We see it some in Psalms, but they were called Elohim, where God actually called some men in the scriptures Elohim, which is to call them gods. And Jesus is throwing back the Old Testament scripture to him. He always did this. He would throw back the Old Testament to prove who he was in the New Testament. And he's saying, look, if God can call them gods, then why do you find it so offensive that I can call myself the Son of God? He goes on to say, after all, the Father set me apart and sent me into the world. Don't believe me unless I carry out my Father's word. But if I do his word, believe in the evidence of the miraculous works I have done, even if you don't believe me, then you will know and understand that the Father is in me and I am in the Father. The theme of the book of John is belief. The theme of the end of chapter 9, chapter 10, is the shepherd. And the shepherd knows his sheep. And so I only have a couple questions for you this morning. Do you know the voice of the Father? Because he says, the sheep know my voice, and I know them. This blind man that was made to see. I mean, I couldn't even imagine being ailed with something like that. It goes back to the conversation that people have all the time. Like, would you rather have been able to see and not be able to see anymore, or would you rather have never been able to see at all? Like, which one would you rather be? People ask that dumb question, right? I'm like, either? But a guy who couldn't see from birth, and now he can see, yet he still didn't believe. Like, dude, you couldn't see anything for 35 years, and all of a sudden you see the beauty of creation, and you don't believe that the guy that healed you just might be Jesus, the Messiah? Yeah, we have people that come to church every day and see some of the same miracles. Some of you that are still with your spouse right now, that's a miracle. Some of you that are financially stable right now, it's just a miracle. It's a miracle. Some of you that your children have not gone their own way and died, it's a miracle. And yet we still live this world where we're not sure if we believe. And some may say, Chris, I believe. How can you say I don't believe? I don't believe an apple tree is an apple tree unless I see the apple. You tracking with me? You can say you believe, but if your life doesn't reflect it, you don't believe. And yet some of us in this room too are sheep, and Jesus says that him and the Father hold us in their hand. Not even the wolf can snatch it out. As long as we're in the gate, in his protection, doing his will. But some of us choose to go out that gate and do our own thing. And Jesus is saying, I'm not out there. You better be careful. And we wander into the darkness. And we've been doing our own thing for a while. And we're wondering, man, has God just left me? Quite the opposite. And you know what? Some of us are, man, we believe. We're living in the pen. We're following the shepherd. We're doing what he says. We hear his voice. We're like, this is so good. Yet Jesus says in number 9, we must quickly carry out the task assigned to us by the one who sent us. Ooh, we got to get to work. 500 homes on the other side of Forest View, another 2,500 coming across the street, apartments and townhomes and everything else, people you work with, people that you go to school with every day, lost and going to hell. Why? Because we're not busy working. We're the shepherd's sheep. We're saving the pen. We believe, but we're not working. Do you think the blind guy could have ever contained himself? I'm not saying, I mean, I could see himself if he's 35. I don't know if he's 35. Let's say he's 35. I could see himself at 35 for the next 50 years going, dude, you're not going to believe this. In 33 AD, I was blind for 30 years. Bam! I could see. How'd that happen? Jesus? Ha! Jesus! You want to know him? Can I introduce you? Month after month, week after week, year after year, I can imagine this guy telling that story. Yet all of us in this room were once blind, and now we can see. We were once dead, and now we're alive. Who have you told? Who are you telling? Like, dude, you're not going to believe it. I used to be this 18-year-old punk that cussed all the time, that disrespected adults. But man, Jesus radically changed my heart. Now I'm a preacher. You want to be a preacher? Forget that. You just want to be a believer? I don't do it all the time. I wish I could tell you that I did. But I'm kind of convicted here, chapter 9. And the sun's going down. The sun is going down. And we got to get busy. So this morning, I don't know if you need to respond. There's time of invitation to say, Chris, I've heard his voice, but I've just never became a sheep. And I want to be a sheep. Or maybe you need to say, Chris, I'm a sheep, but I have this tendency to wander outside the fence. Because I want to do things sometimes my own way. And that, man, I want to get back in the pen. I want to get back underneath the voice of the shepherd. Or maybe you want to say, Chris, I'm good with both of those. But I'm going to agree with you today. The day is ending and night is coming and I got to get busy. Because if you're a believer in Christ in here, you have the second greatest story ever told. Mine is different than yours. Yours is different than mine. I talked to teenagers before, and they'll tell you, Chris, I was never had a dramatic story. Like, I didn't cuss and act like a sailor. I wasn't a Mormon before. Like, you had the story of divorce and death all in your family, which led you to Christ, and some 6'6" guy leading you there. But I don't have that story. Mine's just I went to DBS, and Jesus impressed by my heart, called me to himself, and I responded. Why is that story any less valuable? Because you were blind and now you can see. So was I. You were dead and now you're brought to life. So was I. Tell the story. How will you respond this morning? Would you stand as I pray? Would you respond even before I finish praying? Father, we love you. God, I pray that you would move in the midst of this place. Maybe there's one in this room that does not know you, but today they come to know you as a personal Savior. Maybe there are those in this room that, God, we find ourselves going outside the gate. We find ourselves in chaos and darkness, and God, we are so tired of being tired. God, we want back in. Would you let us cross in? And Father, there's probably those in this room that, like me, don't share the story enough. I was blind. Now I can see. Father, would you give us the strength and the courage to go out of this place proclaiming, shouting, not caring whether anybody believes us or not. Because we know what you've done in our lives. Father, move and do what only you can do, and God will be quick to give you all the honor and all the glory. But we love you and say these things in the precious name of Christ. Amen. As we sing, would you respond?
You.